of all the things that EMFs have been tied to, cell phone use, phone against the head, and brain tumors is where the strongest evidence lies. And that makes the most sense because you have this device that emits high-powered electromagnetic microwaves because they have to reach the cell tower. It's much easier for the cell tower to reach a cell phone. And then, of course, you're putting it right next to your head, so it's blasting at the highest strength right through your sensitive tissue. There's magnetosomes in there and neurons and all these things.
Yeah, my mom's tumor was on the same side of her head that she held the phone to. And yeah, this is one of the canaries in the coal mine, so to speak, that we have now, is seeing glioblastoma and other kinds of brain tumors increase in the last, 20 years. You know, cell phones, early 90s, but they got really more high power and high power and high power. So there's a little bit of a latency period. And then we see this increase in brain tumors. So it's really concerning. And at younger ages, too. Like, my mom was 73. Okay, she was kind of old. But we're seeing an increase in younger age groups, too, with these brain tumors that really have no business being there. Strand breaks in DNA. Your body has repair mechanisms, right? So the key point here is, like, Stefan, when you and I came out of our mamas, you know, we weren't immersed in this much wireless tech.
I was thinking about this today.
It took a while, right? We didn't come out and, you know, there was no concern about a digital pacifier giving your kid an iPhone at the restaurant. But now our kids have a much longer amount of time where they are growing up with this in the environment. The more DNA breaks you have, the more stress on your body, and we're speaking very generally here, right? Like, but the more chances that that happens in your life, the more chances that you miss that repair process somewhere that cancer starts. And these kids are getting it from a young age, you know, and chances are cancer is going to go up in these current and next generations because of this. Sleep is a key time to allow your body to not have that interference from the environment, to be able to run its regenerative processes, autophagy, apoptosis, you know, proper melatonin signaling. Your brain is doing a ton of housekeeping when you sleep. And people have their cell phone on their nightstand, you know, they leave the Wi-Fi router on all night.
What are some, like, the worst sources of electromagnetic fields that people will encounter, let's say in the city, in the town?
Yeah. It's wireless. It is wireless. So Wi-Fi, cellular, Bluetooth, all of this smart tech, you know, your smart fridge, smart electric meter on the side of the house.
I heard those are really noisy.
A smart baby monitor. Yeah, it's just all in this microwave section. And like, I have a chart that I show sometimes of the frequency allocations for the United States, and it is just packed. It's like a crazy rainbow chart. There must be 1,000 different bands in there or more, you know, for medical, for government, for military, for consumer. So in the city, you are surrounded by so many people. They all have multiple devices now, you know, AirPods, smartwatch, smartphone. They've got Wi-Fi router, Wi-Fi access points, smart TVs, all kinds of smart, quote, we'll do quotes on that because I don't think it's very smart. But we are awash in a soup of wireless radiation. This stuff is invisible, right? So it's dehydrating us at a cellular level. So I go into homes when I work with clients and I can find 15, 20 wireless devices, you know, without even really trying. Mm. There's just so much. It's being incorporated into the new tech, the washers and dryers. Anytime you replace something now, if you're concerned about this, you need to do some due diligence, dig into the paperwork, look at the marketing and the packaging, because it's probably going to have smart features on it, and that is not good. and our homes are just being filled up with wireless around the clock too.
With all this electromagnetic energy that we're pumping into the atmosphere, and the higher frequency these waves go, the more they pulse per second, the larger this effect is going to be. The higher frequency waves will dissipate out faster, and a lower frequency wave will not attenuate as quickly, can travel further. And that's why you need less 2G towers than you need 3G. You need less 3G towers than 4G because it has a lower frequency wavelength. And so people may be wondering, why are these 5G towers everywhere, like literally on every block? It's because it's a higher frequency and therefore it attenuates out faster. They need to pump more energy into those to cover a smaller radius. And the reason why they do that is because it's a higher frequency, it can carry more information in its waveform. But that's why you see 4G towers, you know, not that often. It's like every hillside or something. But the 5G ones, if you live in a place with them, it's like every couple blocks you see them, and they're smaller. They don't need to be as large. That's a big change just in the past, what, not even 3 years that we're seeing.
Yep. Yep. You know, the attenuation is different with these higher frequencies, kind of like you were saying. So even on a foggy day or a rainy day, they knew designing these systems that it wasn't going to go, the signal wasn't going to go very far from a millimeter wave high band 5G. And so, yeah, mm-hmm. they're talking about hundreds of thousands of new antennas, and you've probably seen them. They're already here, definitely. Closer to your homes, your businesses, particularly in high population areas. I would tell everyone to switch their home network to a hard-lined system.
So Ethernet
cables, right? I've written a detailed article on my site on everything you need to know.
I'll put a link below.
Yeah, awesome. This is just the low-hanging fruit. Ethernet is significantly faster than wireless. It's less hackable. It's biologically much better for us. It's just a no-brainer, and it's really DIY. You don't have to be some kind of tech genius to pull it off. Like, if you read this article, get the stuff you need, you can take action on it. The wireless, like I said earlier, is the biggest piece. So that's the place to start. The second place is going to be your light environment.
Hi, everyone. I hope you enjoyed that clip from episode 7 of my podcast, Stefan Burns Live, on EMFs with electromagnetic radiation specialist Shane Reilly. You can watch the full interview by clicking the thumbnail here.